I can't decide what I need to recover from all my bad hairstyles in the previous video, or all of Justin's innuendos. Everything he said is basically true, but I didn't say drop them. I said pull your pants down. Okay. Just like to be accurate. As you know, I am a control freak. I'm not sure my speech will be as entertaining, but I do mean it. It is a great honor to receive this award, and I'm grateful and appreciative for the acknowledgement that this implies. But there's something finite about an award, and I would like to reflect for a moment on the things in my life which have not been and continue to not be finite. I have always been fortunate to have people around me who believed in me. Starting with my ballet teacher, Christopher Flynn, in Detroit, Michigan, who told me at the age of 14 that I was special, that I needed to believe in myself, that I needed to go out into the world and pursue my dreams. Those words meant everything to me because I can assure you at the time I didn't feel special. And then there was Dan Gilroy. He lived in an abandoned synagogue in Queens with his brother Ed. They played in a band together. I was sick of being an out-of-work dancer, so he taught me how to play guitar. And every day when Dan and Ed would go to work on their day jobs, I would sneak down to the basement and I taught myself how to play the drums listening to Elvis Costello records. And I practiced those four chords that Dan taught me over and over and over again. I wrote my first song in that synagogue. It was called, ironically, Tell the Truth. I remember that moment so vividly. I remember the hair standing up on the back of my arms, and I thought to myself, who just wrote that song? That wasn't me. I felt like I had been possessed by some magic. And luckily for me, I have been miraculously and continuously possessed by some kind of magic. And even now, my manager, Guy Osiri, who's out there somewhere in the audience watching right now, says to me almost every day, Em, anything is possible. Just tell me what it is you want to achieve. And he really means it. 35 years later, people are still encouraging me to believe in my dreams. What more could I ask for? There's a saying in the Talmud that for every blade of grass, there's an angel that watches over it and whispers, grow, grow. And I can still hear those angels whispering. And even the naysayers, the ones who said that I was talentless, that I was chubby, that I couldn't sing, that I was a one-hit wonder, they helped me too. They helped me because they made me question myself repeatedly, and they pushed me to be better. And I am grateful for their resistance. I know that I would not be here right now without all of it, without all of you, because life, like art, is a collaboration. And I did not get here on my own. And why would I want to? There's no way that I could ever imagine that my life would unfurl as it has. In one way, it feels like a series of suddenlies. One day I was a struggling dancer in Manhattan, and then suddenly I was teaching myself how to play the drums in a synagogue in Queens. And then suddenly I was in a band, and I was doing gigs at CBGB's in Max's Kansas City. And then suddenly I met Seymour Stein hooked up to an IV drip in a hospital bed. And then suddenly I got signed to Sire Records. And then suddenly I was rolling around on the floor at the MTV Awards with my ass hanging out. What nobody knows is that I lost one of my high heels and I dove to the ground to find it. And suddenly it was a dance move. Yikes. And then I had to go backstage and look at my manager, who was white as a ghost, freaking out and telling me I just ruined my career. What did he know? Then suddenly, I was on the stage at Madison Square Garden, and I looked out into the audience, and every girl was dressed like me. Freak me out. Anyways, suddenly, that's one way of looking at it. The other way of looking at it is that everything happened exactly as it was supposed to happen. That I worked with the amazing people I was supposed to work with, that I traveled to the amazing places I was supposed to travel to, that I made the mistakes that I was supposed to make. That the universe would conspire to help me and guide me all the way up to this moment where I am standing in front of you. And finally, I have the chance to say thank you to so many people. First and foremost, I would like to thank my record company, Warner Brothers, whom I have been signed to for my entire recording career. Not many people can say that. And then there's Michael Rosenblatt. I wish he was here tonight. He's the person that more or less discovered me in a nightclub in Manhattan. He told me what he was an A&R guy at Sire Records. I had no idea what an A&R guy was, but it sounded important. So I jammed my demo tape into his hand. We both did a tab of ecstasy, and then we danced the night away. That's the truth. Which leads me to the next person I have to thank, and that is Seymour Stein, and I do think he's here tonight. Seymour, where are you? Somewhere. The legendary Seymour Stein. Yes. To know Seymour is to love Seymour. Yeah. Who takes meetings with people when they're hooked up to IV drips in a hospital bed? Okay? I mean, I thought the guy was gonna die. But he asked me, he was wearing boxer shorts, by the way, and a t-shirt. It was a little bit strange. He asked me to play my demo tape for him, and I just happened to be carrying a boombox with me. So, yeah. So I played my music, and he seemed to like it. And anyway, Seymour's still alive and well, which is great news. Thank you, Seymour.